today, he's a rock star, you know? Back then, he was some dorky kid.
He's a leader, and he's a kind of pioneer.
There's only a handful of artists that become successful for so long.
Richie Hawtin has been one of the most important players in the techno scene for a long time. Since the late 80s, he's been known as a DJ, producer, label owner, and musical visionary. He's got a special reputation as a sound and technology adventurer, as someone who tries to push the limits of techno sound and DJing. As such, he has made a worldwide name for himself that goes well beyond his scene. But behind his success story, there are years of hard, continuous work. No doubt, without his unbroken passion and his endless commitment to the music and the scene, his career would have turned out quite differently. Richie Hawtin and his brother Matthew spend their early years in Banbury, a small English town near Oxford. They lead a sheltered, carefree life in a big family. The mother alone has 12 siblings. Richie develops into a bright, extroverted boy who has no trouble making friends. The father loves music. Kraftwerk, Pink Floyd, John Peel. A definite influence also on young Richie. At the age of 9, Richie immigrates to Canada with his family, as his father takes on a job as robotics engineer with General Motors. The family of 4 moves to Windsor, Ontario. Only the Detroit River separates the city from the US car city Detroit. Richie's new life starts in the quarter La Salle.
When I moved to Canada, my whole world got turned upside down a little bit. You know, I went from a small city in England with such a large group of friends, knowing everybody, and also having a huge family network. And the day we landed in Canada, it was, you know, cutting all of that off. And then it became all about just my, you know, immediate family, just my mom and dad and my brother. You know, before we got here, we sat, you know, in my parents' house, you know, looking at books of Canada. And all the books of Canada were about the nature. It was like, this is where you're going, bears and mountains and streams, nature, nature, nature. And when we landed, it was the completely opposite of that. We came into this big city of automobiles with, you know, mess everywhere, all over the place. It was just like, you know, like as a little kid, and everything was even more exaggerated. And it was like, where are we? It was so alien. In Windsor, you know, once we got into school and things, it was, I think that was really when I noticed the change in myself. In England, I was an extrovert. Once I came to Canada, I was more of an introvert. In England, it was, you know, I was in a way the center of attraction. And in Canada, it became a little bit strange. I remember the kids all being fascinated by my brother and I because we were the new kids from faraway land. We had a really strange accent, you know, so, you know, and I remember the kids being a little bit harsh in a way, you know, bugging us about our accent because we talked funny, because we acted funny, we thought differently. You know, for myself, I just became much more connected to Matthew and much more connected internally.
Richie has difficulties adjusting to his new environment. The boy feels like an outsider and spends a lot of time at home. It is his father, Mick, who awakened the 10-year-old's interest for technology.
From a very early point, I remember my dad always being into electronics and technology. You know, I always have the memory of my dad sitting in front of his, you know, hi-fi and speakers and big reel-to-reel players, you know, listening to music, and also always seeing electronic gadgets around. You know, small things for testing currents and wires and soldering irons, and also my dad, you know, sitting in front of things, fixing them or making them.
That's what you used to carry around instead of an MP3 player in 1960. Or 1963, 65, 66. This was made in 1964. It still works.
Uprights and the rear roof section.
Well, his dad is an integral part of everything he does. I mean, he helps him design all of his special instruments and mixers and controllers. I mean, there's just an incredible close relationship there. I was so impressed by his dad for most of my years that I never even talked to him. I specifically didn't. We used to call him the secret weapon, you know, whenever he used to come in the room, we just let him pass.
My dad likes toys. Period. If it's electronic or if it's a video game or if it's like a little remote control car, if it's electronic and it does something, he wants one, he wants to take it apart and see how it functions and then see if he can modify it.
Sound okay?
Sometimes there was something that I think he wanted that the way to get it was to get it for me for Christmas or for a present, you know. I think that's how he talked to my mom about it. So it was always something coming in, and you know, you would play with the toy, you would make something out of it, and then you would come the next day and my dad would be playing with it, you know. So it was, I think, that fascination. My dad's still a big kid.
They had all the games. They had the Atari. They had Odyssey, whatever games that they could play. And he would have a game, and within half an hour, he would have done that game. I want another game then. And he said, you know, I really want a computer. And we said, well, why? Well, I can make my own game. And we laughed. And we said, there's no way you could possibly make your own game. Oh, yes, I can. So we thought, what the heck with it? So we bought him a basic VIC-20 or something, yes, and or 64. And he sat there and he did things, and he actually got things going across that he had programmed in. And we were absolutely amazed that he could do that.
Once the VIC-20 came into my house, first I lost my eyesight because I had perfect 20/20 vision. And once I had that computer, I just sat in front of the TV for hours and hours and hours. You know, I stopped going out. It's a wonder I didn't become like a little mutant just sitting there, you know, in the darkness playing with computers the whole time.
We honestly thought that, you know, this was what he was going to be doing in life, with a real job, perhaps with computers.
Richie's fascination with computers remains, but now he also starts opening up to his surroundings a bit more again. He gains new friends and joins a small group of kids who, like him, are interested in alternative music and fashion.
In high school, I was, you know, not only part nerd, being in the computer team, but also part what they would call scary. You know, I was more alternative. As I started to get into music then, I started to get into things that were, you know, industrial or whatever. I was wearing a lot of black, you know, I was wearing eyeliner, so I was like the freak nerd.
When I first met Richard, when he was about 16 or 17 years old, he had a blonde fringe haircut that I used to make fun of him because I told him he looked like the Phil Oakey from the Human League, just blonde. He would have this big, huge sweep over his face. He obviously was born in England and had a little bit more of an affinity for British fashion, I think, than a lot of people that were in our, you know, peer group at the time.
When I did start to find a network of friends, when I did find something that I felt part of, it was about music and other kids who were also like, you know, the fringe people, the people who didn't fit in so well. Sometimes you would get ridiculed for looking gay or wearing eyeliner or being a computer nerd. You know, I felt really connected to and part of something, and I liked that I was different.
It is with some members of this circle that Richie starts taking regular excursions to the neighboring Detroit. He visits alternative concerts and buys cool clothes, which he couldn't get in the small Canadian Windsor.
A lot of my friends grew up with a really negative attitude towards Detroit. Their parents wouldn't go there. Their parents wouldn't take their kids there. You know, it was really like, that's no man's land. Detroit was considered the murder capital of the USA. So it definitely didn't have a good reputation. It was always another step towards being different than the rest of the people in Windsor. You know, they didn't go there, and so we were there. Oh yeah, we were in Detroit the whole weekend. We went, you know, resale clothes shopping. We did this and that. And some people were just like, are you crazy?
Detroit stands for industry, but Detroit is more than that. In the mid-80s, various Detroit radio stations and clubs spread a new electronic sound. Matthew, Richie's younger brother, is a regular listener of these trendy radio shows and makes his brother aware of this. The show of Jeff Mills, aka The Wizard, fascinates the two especially.
Jeff and those guys were playing a real mix. It was a perfect way to get someone like me deeper into, you know, techno and house music, because they played a mix of early hip-hop and alternative, industrial. They were playing Yellow, they were playing Front 242 and Nitzareb, all this stuff mixed together with Chicago acid house and Detroit techno. And maybe without that kind of connection to industrial, I wouldn't have been brought in. But that was kind of the doorway. That was kind of what sucked me in first.
Inspired by these new musical developments in Detroit, his interest in electronic music grows. He buys his first records. It is in a teeny bar in Windsor called Hoppers that Richie organizes a party on which he takes his first steps in DJing.
The club was completely dead all the time. They were like, okay, if you really think you can get your friends here, then you have a job. And it was really that simple. We walked in, you know, and 1 hour later I walked out with my DJ job. Now, the important thing, I think, for Hoppers and for those times was it put me in front of a crowd and got me, you know, a little bit more into the idea of DJing. You know, that was when I think it really, the bug bit me. I was like, hey, this is really cool. The best thing about the Hoppers was that, you know, I talked the management into giving me enough money to book Jeff Mills. So I became the promoter. We talked to Jeff, we talked to his manager, and we actually brought Jeff over to Hoppers to play, maybe to like 100, 200 people. This was, for me, like an amazing moment, because we had, you know, I'd never met Jeff. We'd only heard these mixes for like a year or something. And to see him playing in front of us, You know, we were just all in the booth just watching him. You know, it's like, I don't know how, if he had any fun. I don't know if anyone was dancing. We were just like watching. And he was like playing so fast, throwing his records everywhere. And he was playing all the records that I had listened to for the last year. And he was like, choo, choo, choo. And we were sitting in the back helping him sort his records and just copying all the records names down. And finally, I was like, oh, that's what that is. And then went to the record store the next day. I need to buy these records. And it was unbelievable.
Richie is hooked. With the same enthusiasm and ambition that he put into computers and technology before, he now follows his new goal, to become a DJ. Shortly after the party with Jeff Mills, he meets his great idol for the first time, Derek May.
The first time I met Richie was hilarious. He was a skinny little white boy, right? And I'm actually playing records at his university. More or less, I was doing an interview with the radio announcer. And this kid walks up to me like any other time when a kid walks up to me, right? But this kid was like really jumpy, kind of hyper. And he walks up to me and he says, wow, I always wanted to meet you. You know, this whole thing, it was real cool. But at the same time, it wasn't just like a groupie or some sort of kid that just wanted an autograph. This is a kid who I sometimes feel people that really want to do it. I don't know if they'll make it. I don't know if they will do it, you know, really in reality. I don't ever maybe meet them again. But there was something really kind of like interesting about him at that time. It was just a one meet. It was really quick. But he really wanted to make a point that he wanted to be a DJ and he was really serious about it.
The basement club, The Shelter, and the alternative concert location, St. Andrew's Hall, in the same building, are two of the hippest underground locations in downtown Detroit in the 80s. At the weekend, a mix of industrial, Chicago house, and Detroit techno is played at The Shelter. It becomes a regular hangout place for Richie and his friends. This is where he watches the work of resident DJ Scott Gordon with great interest.
He would just stand there and watch and stand there and watch. He was a quiet kid, shy guy, wore glasses, unassuming. In fact, I'd go as far as saying a little bit nerdy. And so he would eventually, we'd start talking and I blew him off for quite a while, as most DJs think they're pretty cool and don't really want to talk to anybody. Finally, I gave him a shot. I think I had to go to the bathroom or something and I needed somebody to play a record for me. And this kid was standing there and I just sort of grabbed him and pulled him in the booth and said, take over for a minute. And that's really where it started, because that kid's name was Richie Hawtin.
Not long after that, Richie has secured a DJ job in The Shelter. Richie does the warm-up set for Scott Gordon. He bridges the gap of time between Scott finishing his radio show on 96.3 FM and arriving at The Shelter.
Good tone.
He was maybe 18, maybe 17, something like that at this time. And he would have to come over to my house to get my records, because he didn't have a record collection at that point. So he would, you know, he'd have to go all the way from the suburbs of Windsor, Ontario, to the suburbs of Detroit, Michigan, when he would show up and he would pick up my records, and, you know, and he'd be very shy, quiet, and unassuming, you know, and be very polite to my mother. And he'd pack the records in his car, and then he'd drive all the way back downtown Detroit, where the shelter is.
At that time, I thought I'd become a really good DJ. You know, I learned later that I wasn't very good. But so I definitely was confident when I started with Scott, but really, really, really nervous. My friends would come early, and, you know, they were like, oh, okay, play later. Let's hope Scott comes later. We want to dance, you know, let's more people come. You know, usually Scott would come just as, you know, the club was filling, and he'd be like, okay, thank you very much. Now it's my turn, and take all the glory, right? And sometimes he would come a little bit later, and that extra 20 minutes was like something really special.
Well, back then, I paid him zero, no money. He didn't do it for money. And that's probably why I loved him so much back then, you know? But today, I want to offer him like tons of money, and he won't even play for me.
After the shelter, Richie regularly visits the Music Institute, one of the most important addresses for electronic music in Detroit. The after-hour club is predominantly a meeting place for a small Afro-American scene celebrating the new sound in the city, techno.
I think when the Music Institute was around, it was special for anyone, even Detroit people, to come over to listen to music that was not normally heard, that was a unique environment. So I guess for people from Windsor to come over, it was definitely a challenge just to come to Detroit in general. Didn't go to a late night after club. You had to have a little guts, you know, you had to take some chances because you didn't know how safe it was going to be or what could happen to you. So, especially being that young, you know, so it definitely was, I think, a challenging thing to do. But the music, you know, that's what music do to you sometimes.
The nights in the Music Institute make Richie want to be a part of the scene and to produce this kind of music himself. His friend Carl Kowalski, who works in the Dr. Disc record shop in Windsor, introduces him to John Acquaviva, who harbors similar desires. John has been working as a DJ for quite a while and owns his own home studio in London, Ontario.
I invited John to come down and meet Richard and Dan Bell at a club called The Shelter in Detroit, thinking that they might get along just, you know, as friends, nothing more than that. Maybe they'd want to do some work together, but we didn't really think anything of it at the time.
I ended up at John's house, and he was living with his parents. And downstairs, you know, in the basement next to the washing machines and next to the clothes hanging up for drying was a small studio. You know, and it was a good situation. We just recorded and recorded, you know, and just played with machines. This was the first time I was really like in a studio myself, a serious studio. And the main thing I remember about that first day was that John had a TR-909 drum machine. And, you know, I sat there, he was like, here, check this out. And as soon as I turned this thing on, it was really like hearing all my favorite records, you know, at once, because it was the main machine that everyone was using back then. In the early days, I learned only studio stuff from John. It was later on, as we became closer friends and business partners, I learned so much from John. He was my senior in years and so much my senior in intelligence and knowledge. So I was really like I was like a sponge, just sucking everything from John. It was a perfect moment for us to meet. He had just come back from Buffalo. He had had a hard time there. He was really trying to figure out what to do, and he was exhausted. He was really finished. And I came in, and so I was sucking from him all the information and everything, and I gave him this energy and this enthusiasm. He was like, oh, okay, let's do this together. Let's try this.
Richie is getting ambitious. By his 20th birthday, he wants to have released a record. John and Richie produce first tracks and offer them to different labels in Detroit. But no one shows an interest.
By the time we started finishing some things that we liked, you know, honestly, no one else really liked it, you know, or they were too busy. You know, we talked to Derek, we talked to Kevin, not so much to Juan. We had a better connection to those guys. And, you know, I had friends who were friends of them. So they definitely heard, I think, what we were doing, but there wasn't so much really support from them at that point. We took it as they were so busy. They had so many of their friends who were making music and stuff like that. Why are they going to help two kids from Canada?
I remember Richie was trying to get on with Derek and them. That's the first time I seen him at Transmet. Maybe if some of the guys had been home, but they were so busy DJing that people had to start up their own labels. 430 West did, UR did, and I guess Plus 8 did too.
I was a consumer in the older days, so I had lots of credit cards. So we basically started Plus 8 on my credit cards at about 23% interest.
The Visa Gold Card had $5,000 limit, and you know, $5,000 limit back then was just, we were like, wow, we can do everything with this. So we, you know, used that to buy equipment, we used that to make the masters, and we used that to press the records. You know, without that, we wouldn't have got anywhere.
And now, Cyber Sonic.
His credit card pays off. Already the third single release on the newly founded label Plus 8 becomes an underground hit. Technarchy by Cybersonic, a co-production between John Aquaviva, Dan Bell and Richie Hawtin, is particularly successful in Europe and gets the label an international reputation. First booking requests from overseas come predominantly from England, Germany and the Netherlands.
They weren't, it was nowhere glamour, it wasn't glamorous at all. It was, you know, come in, you know, sleep on someone's living room floor, you know, go to the gig and maybe have some food and then, you know, fly back or experience a city for a little bit.
We would have went over and, you know, slept, you know, on a cardboard box or something with and then ate potato chips for 3 weeks if it meant being able to go over and play our music and also just see the scene, you know, to be in England, you know, and see the energy of the whole rave scene, of what was happening then, after reading about it in magazines for 2 years, was incredible. And then after that, to go to Holland and through Germany, you know, it was just so much more intense and so bigger and so much, so well accepted that it gave us energy to continue going back to play, but gave us a lot of energy to come back here and throw parties and make more music, sign new artists, you know, and be part of it.
Clubs sind aus allen Nähten geplatzt. Da ist eine Plus 8 Nummer gelaufen und alles sind steil gegangen. Ja, es wird da gefeiert in der, sag ich mal, Underground-Szene als Superstar und das war halt für den Richie hundertprozentig inspirierend. Er ist ja mit offenen Armen überall empfangen worden. Und er war eigentlich sehr schüchtern, muss ich sagen. Er wusste teilweise, glaube ich, gar nicht so recht, wo er hingucken soll oder wie es um ihn geschieht.
But the internationally celebrated Cybersonic record of the three Canadians does not meet with the same enthusiasm in the techno scene of Detroit.
We put on this white label the future sound of Detroit. And that was very important because it was our first record to tell the world, hey, we are the next generation of people coming from Detroit.
It upset a lot of people that feel that, you know, Detroit is theirs and this is they sacred ground or whatever. I think it was done actually out of respect, you know, where these guys really admired the Detroit music. It influenced them.
A lot of people commented that we were coming in and taking a piece of Detroit or doing this and that. And they can say what they want. You know, I just felt we had ideas, we had visions, and we wanted to share. The heart of Plus 8 was Detroit, but with some of the criticisms or people saying you're not really from Detroit, well, we were international. Plus 8 was not a sound of one city, of one sound. We also wanted to grow.
By now, Richie has set up his own small studio in his parents' basement. In his UTK, under the kitchen studio, as he calls it, he now also works on solo productions, which he releases under the name of Fuse and Circuit Breaker. In 1992, Richie is completely enraptured by a DJ set by Derek May on a party in Detroit. The sound and the new tracks, which are created during the mixing, make him go into a two-day marathon studio session soon after, in which he records a new album, Sheet One, the debut album of his arguably most famous project, Plastic Man.
The whole scene was very, very intense. We were doing experimenting a lot when we were playing, and when we were partying. We were taking quite a lot of acid at this point in my life, and the idea for the name came out of this. We were organizing a party that got shut down by the police. You know, we didn't know it was going to get shut down by police, so we had all just taken acid, and then we're like, shit, you know, what are we going to do now? Like, we have no party, we're just sitting here, we're all going to start tripping in half an hour. So we all went to my friend's house and just kind of like hung out, and I ended up lying on a floor like this and sinking into the floor and becoming plastic. Some of my friends were dancing, and they were always dancing really in this, you know, really weird way that to us it didn't look like it was possible, you know? And it was, so it was always this like kind of joke. It's like, you know, plastic man, plasticity. I was in Milton Keynes staying with Eddie Richards on one of my, you know, one of the DJ tours I was doing. And we had this call, and these a guy called Seth Hodder and Pepe Jantz called. They said, hey, we're from Mute. We really want to meet you guys. Could we, you know, come out to Milton Keynes? And we're like, you're going to come all the way out on a train, like 2 hours to meet with us? Cool. It was like everything we wanted, right? And to know they were from Nova Mute, from Mute Records, from, you know, Daniel Miller, it was like, you know, I think we were doing backflips just to meet someone from there.
Yeah, things are going okay with the Plastic Man release. Trying to get another single out of them. It seems as though Plasticine is proving very popular with the German DJs.
The cooperation is sealed. The Sheet One album is released on Plus 8 and Nova Mute in 1993, and it has achieved its definite place in the Hall of Fame of techno history.
The success of Plastic Man was really an organic one. I mean, in retrospect, people think it was big splash. What Richie did in the 90s with his artist side was really a slow organic growth. It was always about a long-term vision. There was no big hits. It wasn't like Speedy J or Cybersonic, you have a big hit and you sell a lot. Plastic Man was an album.
I think the reaction was quite mixed because what he was doing was so minimalistic, and a lot of people really didn't understand it at all. And then there are other people who totally understood it. So it was, I think it had quite a split reaction as far as I remember. People loved it or kind of hated it really.
The project Plastic Man develops into a cult. The logo of the dancing goblin turns into a symbol of identification for many fans. It becomes one of the first genuine techno brands ever.
The cult really hit its peak in about 1993-94. And there was, you know, you would see people with Plastic Man tattoos across their entire back. And you'd see people with massive Plastic Man logos on their cars. It got a little crazy. I mean, some people probably did some things that, you know, we're probably regretting today, but certainly there was a time when that was almost out of control.
People always come in with things like this or presents. We did a Halloween party and there was like 30 pumpkins and Plastic Man things. It's, people are crazy, so that'd be cool though.
But it is not only thanks to his Plastic Man project that Richie hits the limelight. It is also his cleverly devised elaborate parties in and around Detroit which make waves.
I think Richie and the Plus 8 label brought a lot of the suburban white kids into the scene. When Derek and all them guys was over in Europe DJing the party, the people that threw the parties fell off. And Plus 8 kind of stepped up and filled that void.
And they became legendary. I mean, there's people just would just, you know, he would spin for 3, 4, 5, 6 hours, and just the energy level would never die out. And word was getting around, and people were loving it because it was new to them. The scene really, really blew up, and Richie's parties were some of the most still talked about parties today.
Er hat mich eingeladen und auf seine Hardcore-Events, die da macht. Und die Party, die gemacht hat, da hat also wirklich alles aufgefahren, was ging. Also mit verschiedenen Knöpfen, die ich dann bedienen konnte. Dann ging da eine Rakete los, da hat es gescheppert, da kam ein Superstrobe und das war so laut. Ich glaube, ich habe noch nie in so einem lauten Raum gestanden. Das war mir schon echt, ich habe schon leicht Panik bekommen.
They did a lot of parties. The one I remember the best was at the Packard Building. I didn't go to every Richie party. I don't go to every anybody's party, but that one seemed interesting because it said the Plastic Man. So I wanted to see what was the new thing they came up with this time.
He'd hired or he'd borrowed or something, an old warehouse, and the whole place was lined with black plastic sheeting, and there were these little tunnels that you had to walk down, these little rooms made all out of black plastic, and it was just, and the music was, you know, dark and minimal, and the whole atmosphere just, and the Detroit was pretty, you know, downtown Detroit at that time was pretty fucked up.
For his parties, Richie can always count on the support by his family. A lot of the time, his parents are not only present, but also help him organize.
His mom, of course, used to work the door at all the events, and she became sort of a second mom to the rest of us. So I know for a fact that he and his parents have always been and will always be incredibly close because they're part of the organization.
I often help at parties. I've been on the door taking money because sometimes it's a little difficult getting people that you can truly trust. We've been there on a couple of occasions where we've actually helped clear up at the end, and that was a bit of an eye-opener, the stuff we were sweeping up off the floor, but that's another story. When people come up and sort of say they're his brother, his cousin, etc., that usually happens when I'm on the door and I've usually got the guest list and people are come and say, oh, I'm Richie's, you know, cousin or brother or whatever, and I usually say, really? And I'm his mum. And that's it right there.
Nearly everything Richie touches at this time works out well. But he has still got to fight with the fact that many people from the Detroit techno community don't want to accept him.
Somewhere between, I would say, 1993 and 1997, there was a time when Richie was hated here in Detroit because he was good. You know, he was white and he was good. And he got what seemed like to some opportunities and advantages that others didn't get. So, and some of that might be true, but I don't think that you could, I don't think that Richie would sit up and admit and, or even be able to possibly stand behind some sort of conspiracy, you know, to outmaneuver the Detroit guys and get a career opportunity and blacklist or assassinate people's characters so that he could get a record deal and somebody else couldn't from Detroit. So I think it was unfortunate that he just happened to be white. He just happened to be good. Some guys just didn't like that, really. But he had to fight hard to get the respect, and he got it.
It was never anything aggressive. It was never anything overt where people would, you know, tell us, you know, you don't belong here, get out. It was just more of a situation where we never really felt welcome. And even though we try and welcome them into our scene, they just didn't seem to want to be a part of it. So it still remained that divide. And there were certain people that did cross that line, and it was great for everyone.
In 1995, I was on my way to a party in New York to do a show, we were doing a Plastic Man tour. And this was a day after the Oklahoma City bombing. And so, to fly to New York, I had to go over the bridge. And my brother and I pulled up, both shaved heads, equipment and everything in the back. And they were like, where are you going? I was like, I'm going to my friend's house to record, just to play around. And they were like, pull over. You know, I don't know if it was like, you know, I'd been back and forth a lot, but it was really the timing, you know, and the way we looked, the timing, and the American border that day was just hardcore. And they pulled us apart, started to ask us some questions about where we were going, what we were doing. And at this point, we didn't know this. They looked in the car and they found a letter. And in it was like, blah, 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 blah. See everyone in New York, Plastic Man live show on this date, which happened to be that date. And so they pulled my brother apart, you know, and questioned us for 3 or 4 hours, knowing what we were doing, but never telling us. In the end, they were like, look, just tell us where you're going. We know you're going to New York. Tell us and everything will be, you don't have to sit here anymore. You really don't want to stay overnight here. I was like, oh, okay. And I told everything that was happening. And once I did that, they had me for two things. They had me telling a story, what I first told, and then they had me telling the truth. And once I told them the truth, they were able to just throw the book at me and say, see you later, you're not allowed into the States ever again. Now, for me, this was, you know, how can you explain it? It was the biggest blow to my career, my life ever, really. My girlfriend at the time was living in Detroit. All my friends, 90% of my friends were in Detroit. This was at the height of Plastic Man in Detroit. And so, yeah, then it was all gone.
We'd go to Windsor as much as possible. I mean, a lot of parties moved there. You know, his birthday party was there. A lot of the plus eight parties had moved up there. So we would go across the border. It was still something that we didn't expect was going to take more than a couple of weeks. And it ended up being like a couple of years. But we were, you know, we were trying to keep our heads up about it. We were sending, you know, free Plastic Man faxes with him, like behind bars and things like this, trying to make some fun out of it. But it was a pretty serious thing for a while.
I'm an optimist. Now I look at it like, you know, in a really good way, because, you know, the Plastic Man hype was so extreme at that point. I don't know what else we could have done. The parties in Detroit were completely off the hook. I don't know where it could have gone. You know, it may have been an explosion ready to happen. So at that moment, I had to rethink everything.
It is at a great cost that his lawyers managed to shorten his eviction order from an unlimited period to 18 months. Richie uses the involuntarily gained time to concentrate more on his label and to experiment with new sounds in the studio. During this time, he creates the concept series, for which he releases a 12-inch once a month for a year. The discipline this project requires gives him new creative energy. His sound evolves, becomes more experimental and more minimal. The concept series does not become as successful as the Plastic Man project, but it has a great impact on Richie Hawtin's musical development. It is the turning point into his more minimal sound, which he stands for today.
When I first came out, the first few were people bought right away because they knew it was, you know, it was something that Richie was doing, and they were hungry for some of his music. But a lot of people were going, this isn't danceable. What's this? Where's he gone? What's wrong? But I think it was good for his soul. Now, though, you know, look on eBay and they'll probably tell you something different.
My brother was always a huge influence on me because always when he was around, he was talking, thinking, and living art. And there was always books around. And through him, I was introduced to people like Sol DeWitt and Mark Rothko. And this is probably like 1997. And I really got sucked into that kind of art world. It was the beginning for me when I was in the studio trying to work on music on this kind of minimalistic sound. It was after Concept, before the Consumed album, and the Mark Rothko paintings and some other things were a way for me to, you know, see what I was trying to do in my head. You know, I was like, okay, this is what it actually looks like. Now, how can I do something like that musically?
Ich glaube, das war einfach so für ihn so ein intuitiv so ein Ding. Das wollte er für sich ausloten. Minimal, Kunst, Musik, Leben. Alles reduzieren aufs Wesentliche und aber vielleicht auch so ein bisschen als Masche, ja, so ich guck mal, wie weit ich da komme, ja, bis am Schluss nur pff, macht.
Richie was very influenced by Rothko, and I think this is a huge part of him also wanting to move on. And we went to two exhibits. We went to the Rothko exhibit in Houston, and there was a Rothko exhibit in the Smithsonian. And looking back, only recently, it dawned on me that it was almost like, at least in a business sense, when we went to the Smithsonian, to the Rothko exhibit, it was like our last date before breaking up.
I think for John at this time, it was, you know, a little bit different from where he was going and where he had come from. You know, we had started out as DJs together. John had come from a disco background, and you know, I didn't really come from an art background, but this influence from my brother and getting more into that started to lead me down a different path, I think. I think it was a natural kind of growth, and we suddenly found each other in slightly different places, you know, along with, you know, in a place where, you know, the label was huge, it was successful, it was busy, there was lots of money flying around, but, you know, that takes a lot of time and energy. And when you start to think, well, maybe I'm not enjoying this, or maybe I want to do something a little bit different, then, you know, you have to find a way to make a change.
Shortly afterwards, Richie founds his own new label, Minus. The label is most of all intended as a platform for his own productions. He wants it to have a simpler structure and to be more transparent than Plus 8.
Minus isn't set up just to release records. It's kind of a mechanism to try out, I guess, use technology for creative purposes. Basically, anything that can be considered creative, but uses technology somehow, uh-huh, is basically what we're interested in.
Although Richie has always felt very connected to Detroit and its scene, He toys with the idea of moving to another city in the late 90s.
I was traveling all, you know, every weekend and always coming back to Windsor and Detroit, and, you know, but it was just so hard for me to think about actually leaving and calling another place my home. You know, I attribute, like, you know, all my success, you know, is, you know, to Detroit and to Windsor. Sometimes it was like, okay, perhaps if I leave, I lose my success. Perhaps it's so tied to this location, I can't leave. I couldn't, I shouldn't leave. You know, those people who had supported me and, you know, the party scene, the friend, it's like, you know, can I just say, see you later? Thanks for all the inspiration. Thanks for getting me where I am, but see you later.
He just outgrew where he was. It's just a fact. I mean, people can say what they want, but when you get to a certain size, in order to continue that growth or continue doing what you set out to do, which is basically, you know, create music and influence ears, is he had to go where the work was, he had to go where the people was. And I think that he outgrew Windsor a long time ago. I think he held on for a very long time before he actually did move away.
That he wanted to either go to New York or Berlin. We all along would have preferred Berlin. In my opinion, he went to New York for the wrong reason.
I guess the reason why I moved to New York, you know, would truthfully be, you know, for a girl, you know. I'd spent so much time, probably, you know, more time than I should have on music and labels and everything around my life, except for a girlfriend of 8 years. And around the New York time, all that crumbled. And I thought the best way to try and put the pieces back together was to go directly where she was at. So I went there for a year. The pieces could never be put back together. But it was a really one of the hardest times of my life, for sure. But in retrospect, a really, you know, enjoyable time. It really, really pushed me, and kind of I had to face a number of things. My life was turned upside down, and out of that came something new.
Moving to New York also changes his appearance. Richie presents himself in a new style and is hardly recognizable anymore.
If someone changes their look a bit, it's not that big of a deal, but, you know, apparently it was in this case because he had this look of shaved head and black rimmed glasses. This was his look, and so to change that was such a big deal for people. And I remember being in London, we played at the End, and he went on, and some fans came up, "Hey, who are you? Where's Richie? We want Richie to play." It's like, "No, it's me, it's me." Said, "No, no, you're not Richie. Look, face is different, everything's different." He's like, "No, I swear." And for about half an hour, maybe longer, he was arguing with these people, and he was even showing them, "Look at my tattoo, look, it's the same tattoo, it's me." And they wouldn't believe it, and they'd never believed it. And so this really went on for a long time, I would say, at least a year and a half, until people really started to realize, okay, yes, he's got hair now. I remember for me, I went to Berlin for the first time, and I knew at that point immediately, okay, I have to come here. This is a change I need as soon as possible. And when I came back to New York and we had this conversation, I said, hey, you know, I'm gonna move to Berlin in 6 months. So he said, what? No, you can't move to Berlin. I'm moving to Berlin. I said, what? No, I'm moving to Berlin. So it was pretty funny that we both kind of felt the same thing, but never really talked about it until then. So, yeah, so then it just happened. We knew, okay, we have to go then.
Coming to Berlin with a bunch of friends for sure is easier, going anywhere. In the end, it was just Magda and I who came together. Tim and my other friends followed later. But definitely, Magda and I were in New York, and I remember leaving New York. I went from New York back to Canada to record the Plastic Man Closer CD. And we sat down like on the last night, and I was like, okay, I'm not going back to Canada unless I know I'm going to Berlin. This can only be a stopover. Because if I go back and I don't go anywhere, this has all been a waste, you know, the whole New York thing. And it was really like, okay, deal. See, next time I see you is in Berlin. And that was the next time I saw Magda.
Yeah, I think in Windsor, Rich was busy traveling and hanging out with his family, working a lot. Now in Berlin, when Rich is not in the studio, I think he really enjoys to hang out with friends. Have dinner, either at his place or somewhere else, go to the park, do normal things. I think he really enjoys his life right now in a big way, and it's really nice to see.
When I'm in Berlin, nearly, you know, jeden Tag, you know, Schule machen, you know.
Wenn ich das könnte, hätte, würde und so weiter. Mm. Das kennst du noch nicht, deshalb kannst du das auch noch wirklich nicht sagen.
Mm. Probieren.
Ich möchte das wirklich probieren. Wirklich probieren. Ich möchte das wirklich probieren. Ja.
Machen ein Tagesbuch.
Ja, wir haben darüber gesprochen. Und hast du schon mit Helmut Müller angefangen?
Ah, ja. Ich bin an Seite 2.
Wow.
Going to school takes me out of my typical situation. Takes me out of the office, takes me away from music and makes my mind work in a different way and think about other things.
Er fühlt sich wohl in Deutschland, er macht Deutsch, er lernt Deutsch. Ja. Spricht mit mir jetzt Deutsch am Telefon, das ist total verrückt. Ja. Mit dem Richie jetzt Deutsch zu sprechen und auch auf einer After-Hour ihm einen deutschen Witz mal zu erzählen. Ja.
For years, fans and critics alike knew him as a serious and rather introverted artist who works on his career very hard and with great discipline. But now, Richie Hawtin is starting to show a completely different side during his gigs. Rumors multiply around him, spectacular DJ performances, and after-hour sessions going out of hand.
I think his behavior has changed in these last couple of years. He still holds it together somehow, like when it comes to understanding music and the business and everything. It's just so normal to him it's so like his background that now the partying and the kind of friends and hanging out and just being more social, it's a new thing for him. You know, not having a girlfriend, not having anyone to kind of keep you on a road or in line. I do hear stories, there's things online that I'll see. It's like, okay, well, here's Rich diving into 2,000 people in Rome from the stage, from the DJ booth, and crowd surfing, you know? This is something that you would not do in Detroit. And you wouldn't have done 10 years ago.
I think his friendship with Sven Vey had a big influence on that, because Sven is such a performer. You know, he's like, you know, he's just out there. You know when he's behind the turntables. And I think Rich became very, was just sort of influenced by that. And he could see how he could reach, I think, reach more people. And I think he could see that it was part of his personality that that he needed to express.
Wir haben jetzt vor kurzem haben wir zusammen gespielt in Kolumbien, in Medellin, und haben uns schon gesagt, hey, jetzt reißen wir den Laden auseinander. Ja. Also es war mit Ansage quasi. Ja. Und da haben wir gesagt, hat er mich gefragt, ob ich mit ihm Ping-Pong spielen möchte. Ja. Ich bin ja eigentlich nicht jetzt so der Ping-Pong-Mensch. Ja. Und da habe ich zum Richie gesagt, du Richie, weißt du was? Ab, mach mal. Naja, und dann sind wir beide da oben so durchgedreht, dass wir jeder erstmal so immer ein Platte und dann... Es ist ganz gut gelaufen. Ich habe aber dann so gemerkt, musikalisch komme ich nicht ganz dahin, wo ich hin will. Dann habe ich zum Richie gesagt, hier, pass auf, ich mache jetzt eine Stunde und dann machst du eine Stunde und den Schluss machen wir wieder zusammen. Gute Idee, machen wir so. Naja, währenddessen er gespielt hat, habe ich dann halt quasi seine, ich sag immer, ich bin dann sein Private Dancer, ja, und da tanze ich halt nur für ihn dann, ja, und schmeiß mich dann halt auch in die Masse rein mit Stage Diving und das ganze Programm, ja. Und dann habe ich dann gespielt, ja, also dann ist er dann quasi vor und hat es genauso gebracht, ja, Richie Stage Diving, ja, und also das muss man sich erst mal vorstellen. Am Schluss haben wir eine Platte aufgelegt, dann sind wir dann zusammen nach vorne und dann sind wir zusammen in die Leute, in die Masse reingesprungen und die haben uns natürlich den ganzen Laden getragen, ja. Dann haben wir uns die Plattencover aufgezogen, ja, haben da ein bisschen Napoleon gespielt, ja, und sind total durchgedreht, ja. Ich meine, so habe ich Richie auch noch nie erlebt. Das war für uns also auch also schon eine sehr spezielle Performance.
Maybe there's an eclipse happening. His persona and his identity in public eye is starting to eclipse what he is known for and has been known for in the studio, for making music. So I think it's confusing for people to try to figure that out. They know Plastic Man as a very cerebral, techno, minimal producer and the music that goes along with that. But I think now they're seeing this element of DJing so much and working on music way less than he used to, and how that's actually affecting, you know, his music.
Richie lotet gerne die Grenzen aus für sich, ja, und in allen Bereichen. Und der Richie kann auch Push the Limits mäßig unterwegs sein, ja. Aber ich schätze den Richie nicht so ein, dass es ihm gefährlich werden könnte. Dafür ist er viel zu schlau. Auch wenn er vielleicht mal auch abfährt oder mal eine Zeit hat, wo er das Gaspedal durchdrückt oder so, ja. Weiß ich ganz genau, der weiß ganz genau, wo die Break ist. Ja, er hat noch viel zu viele Ideen und Visionen und er will noch zu viel kreieren, dass er sich da nicht aus der Bahn schleudern lässt.
The amount of DJing versus studio work and just the way my life is running right now, I think definitely it's a phase. Without partying and some quite extreme moments and freakout sessions in Detroit early on, there would have been no Plastic Man Sheet One album or any of this. You know, that didn't come out of me just sitting at home twiddling my thumbs and playing with, you know, computers and knobs. Something else went wrong there, you know? And I think
once I got to New York and once I got over here, or around that time, you know, I was trying to find time to, you know, to be more relaxed, have fun. You know, it's, I found this with not only with myself, but a lot of people around the same time in the late 90s, early 2000. It seemed that, you know, some people kind of got disenchanted with the scene. People were tired of it. They kind of left. And the people who were left, the old people who were left, were like, you know what? We've worked really, really hard to remain consistent and current. And we're here 10 years later, 12 years, 15 years later. But, you know, we've worked hard, but we still love what we do. Let's remember that we love what we do. Let's take time to enjoy it. So maybe I've been enjoying it too much right now. But, you know, I love having fun and partying. I love going out and freaking out with my friends and dancing and going to Panorama Bar. And I also love being locked away from everyone for days in my studio, too. It's again, I need both. I need to kind of shoot myself away from the planet and get away from all this and then bring myself back and figure out what I've learned about myself or my surroundings and take that into my creativity. It's time for another album. I don't know if it's Plastic Man or this and that, but something, you know, it's 10 years now since I did Concept One. So it's time to do something like that. It's time to spend time in the studio finding a new way. And this is what is the important time that I haven't had in the last like 5 or even 10 years. You know, I found the time to record the DJ albums, you know, the Dex Effects. I found time for Closer and Consumed. But, you know, to make another step, you need to find time in the studio, not to record, just to experiment. And that's really what I'm doing now. That's really what my purpose in Berlin is when I'm home, is to spend as much time in the studio, experiment, and see where that takes me. That's exactly like 10 years ago with Concept One. Okay, let's announce I'm gonna do this. Let's start with some sounds. But I had no idea where I was gonna go with it. And 1 year later, I had a whole body of work that you know, to this day, it's one of my most proudest, you know, accomplishments. So, wir sehen.